Good evening, everyone. Today's topic is regarding bone marrow transplant and its implication in critically ill patients. We have been learning a lot about how the hematological malignancies and the critical care has a great interaction. And until and unless we have it as an interaction between a number of the departments, we cannot really pull out a patient from the trouble he's put into regarding his illness. And the amount of critically ill patients in hematological malignancies is really something we deal with the critical care unit support to bring them out. So today we will be having a few slides and exchange knowledge regarding what bone marrow transplant is. And first, because most of us are not aware that bone marrow transplant is now known as stem cell transplant rather than a bone marrow transplant because it does not involve an organ transplant. Like most of us are aware that patients undergo a liver transplant, they undergo a kidney transplant or a renal transplant. Similarly, previously when it all started in the era of 1890s, that is the late 1800 century, it was known as the bone marrow transplant. But later on, as we understood what bone marrow is and how it is functioning and how it is able to actually differentiate into the other cells, it has changed now to hematopoietic stem cell transplant. And to start with, the first transplant was between identical twins and it was in leukemia. So the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine, both of them were given to Murray and Thomas. And this is for the students who are attending the webinar to know that these two are the stalwarts in the field of transplant. So the first malignancy, which was actually in which the BMT was carried out, is leukemia, and it was done in 1950s. So what are the agendas today? What is stem cell or bone marrow transplant? And we have something to share about, as I said, that stem cell and bone marrow transplant, they are actually used interchangeably. And when we say bone marrow, a lot of patients, they fear for the reason that they have to undergo an invasive procedure to harvest the stem cells. So it is a treatment which is used for patients with lymphoma, leukemia, myeloma, a lot of other blood conditions apart from the malignancies. And the stem cells are collected either from the bloodstream or from the bone marrow. Lymphoma, to say it is a cancer of the lymph nodes or the lymphatic system. Leukemia, these are usually the WBCs where there is proliferation of the abnormal white blood cells. And then we have myeloma, which are the WBCs or the plasma cells from which this cancer arises. So these are the common terms. Usually a hematologist, they definitely know about it, but for the general common people, you should know what is a lymphoma, leukemia, and myeloma, because these are not like the lung cancer, the oral cancer, where everyone is very familiar about. So hematopoietic stem cells, this occurs from the multipotent stem cells. Prior to that, there is a pluripotent stem cell. But the multipotent stem cell is actually delineated to a specific lineage, that is the blood cells. So hematopoietic stem cells again divide into the common myeloid progenitor cell and the common lymphoid progenitor cell. From the myeloid progenitors, we have all the blood, cellular blood components except the lymphoid cells. And the common lymphoid progenitor, from there you get the B cells, the T cells, the NK cells. And this is what is shown over here, and also the dendritic cells. Whereas from the myeloid progenitors, we have not only the myeloid, the granulocytes and the monocytes, but we also have the erythrocytes as well as the platelet. Erythrocytes are nothing but the RBCs. So you broadly, we understand that a hematopoietic stem cell again further differentiates into a myeloid precursor and a lymphoid precursor. So if we transfuse these stem cells, definitely they will be able to regenerate all the cellular blood components. So why was it known as a peripheral blood stem cell transplant or a bone marrow transplant? So there are some advantages and disadvantages of both the procedures. Stem cells are collected from the bloodstream, whereas the bone marrow cells, the stem cells are collected from the bone marrow. Previously, when it was all started, bone marrow was the one which was the preferred mode of getting the stem cells, but now most common type is the stem cell, which is harvested from the peripheral blood. In the bone marrow, whenever we are doing the marrow transplants, there is less number of the stem cell dose. Whereas when we are doing it from the peripheral blood, the stem cells number are more. So the engraftment is earlier. The more the number of the stem cells, the better it is, because your patient will come out of the aplasia much earlier than the patients who will undergo a bone marrow transplant with a lesser number of the stem cell. And that is what is known as engraftment. That means the neutrophils will be more than 500 for two consecutive days. And thus, engraftment occurs earlier in the stem cell transplant. The peripheral blood stem cell transplant is a disadvantage with the stem cell transplant. That is, we have more of GVHD. GVHD is called as graft versus host disease. So whenever we are transplanting, we will definitely expect the GVHD. That means the host or the recipient will try to have some reaction and try to avoid the receiving of the cell, or the recipients. The recipient will actually try to, they will have a effect which is known as the graft versus host. The host will not allow the graft to engraft in the host. So therefore, we have more of GVHD in the stem cell transplant, whereas it is much less in the bone marrow transplant. And since GVHD is also associated with the GVL effect, that is known as graft versus lymphoma or a leukemia effect, which is required so that the leukemic cells are not allowed to proliferate in the host. So we also require a GVL. Whenever there is a GVHD, GVL also occurs. So a small amount of GVHD is beneficial to a patient because it does not allow further proliferation of any residual leukemic cells. But that is not required in benign diseases like aplastic anemia, thalassemia, or sickle cell anemia, where also bone marrow transplant or a stem cell transplant is required to cure the disease. As a result, in younger children who have aplastic anemia or inherited marrow failure syndromes, along with thalassemia or sickle cell, bone marrow is a better source than the stem cells from the periphery, because we do not require a GVL effect over there. So less of GVHD has a better outcome and lower morbidity. So this is what the two pictures over here. This is how we collect the bone marrow from the iliac crest from behind, the posterior superior iliac crest. And this is what is known as the peripherally, how we collect the stem cells or the peripheral blood stem cell testing is being done. So this is the difference in two procedures. When we are collecting the cells in a peripheral, from the peripheral blood, it is just within the apheresis machine, like the STP donors. And the way we are collecting the single donor platelets, it is the procedure is just the same. So there is no use of any surgery to bring about this transplant process. So this is the first thing we have to mention it to our donors, that you do not need to be apprehensive that something is lost from you and you're not going to gain back. Like the way a patient can donate their blood cells, the red blood cells, the platelets, similarly, they can donate the stem cells, and the stem cells are back within the donor within a period of 2 to 3 months. So next is the types of transplant. We talked about the bone marrow or the stem cell transplant. The types of transplant are autologous stem cell transplant, or it can be an allogenic stem cell transplant. So the autologous means the patient's own stem cells are used to rescue the patient, whereas in allogenic stem cell, there is a healthy donor to which the stem cells are given. So this is allogenic versus autologous. Again, further, the allogenic stem cell transplant depends upon the type of donor. And this, in fact, depends in turn upon the HLA compatibility. If a patient is full 10 by 10 match, that is known as a match sibling donor, and this happens only with the siblings, that means a patient with his own brother or sister. And then next comes the HLA matched related donor. A brother or a sister may not be fully matched, but still there is a relation, and these are the matched related donor. Apart from that, also parents can be matched related donor or unrelated donor. Suppose a patient does not find any matching with his siblings, then we go for a MUD registry in the MUD, that is matched unrelated donor. There is a registry from where you have to see whether the HLA is matching of the patient with any of the donor, and the one with whom it is matching, then we undertake the transplant process. Next is the HLA mismatch related or unrelated donor. So mismatch at a higher level then occurs, and these are something which are very less offered to the patients. Nowadays, it is the era which is known as the haploidentical donors, because the families are very small or nuclear families. Either the parents are having two children or maximum one children, and in those cases, haploidentical transplants are feasible, which was not feasible earlier. And the last one is the umbilical cord blood stem cell transplant. The problem with the umbilical cord blood stem cell transplant is that the products, the umbilical cord stem cells which are collected from them, the number is very less. So you have to pool a number of cord blood in order to get an number of the stem cells. So what is the principle of the stem cell transplant? The whole aim is, ideology is, first you give a high dose chemotherapy, then you have to infuse the stem cells in order to rescue it. So what happens exactly, once a patient is diagnosed with malignancy, and these are the indications of the autologous stem cell transplant: the myeloma, most commonly used, relapsed Hodgkin's disease, relapsed and refractory DLBCL or any of the non-Hodgkin lymphoma, germ cell tumors, the solid tumors, among them the germ cell tumors and the Ewing sarcoma. So these are the most common indications for autologous stem cell transplant. What happens? A patient first is diagnosed of myeloma. You have to give them some induction chemotherapy, get the patient into a remission status, your initial remission is sufficient enough. Then you prepare the patient, you assess the response, then you prepare the patient for a transplant. So what happens is, first you collect the stem cells out, give a high dose of chemotherapy to ablate the marrow. Ablate means the marrow is completely lost of all its cells. And then you have to again reinfuse the stem cells which you have procured by apheresis, so that in that ablated marrow, this stem cell will enter into their niche, and then they will further differentiate, as I said, into the common myeloid progenitor and the common lymphoid progenitors, and subsequently make up the cellular component of the blood. So this is what we all talked about. First is collection of the stem cells by the process of apheresis. Then you cryopreserve it, or you keep it in the blood bank, give a high dose of chemotherapy, and next, after 12 to 24 hours, you reinfuse the stem cells. So after 10 to 12 hours of chemotherapy, this is done, because if immediately after chemotherapy or within hours of chemotherapy, you give this stem cell, then the stem cells themselves will be lost because of the chemotherapy effect. So we give a period so that the chemotherapy is allowed to ablate the marrow, and at the same time, it also makes place for the new cells to get in. So we talked about autologous and allogenic. What are the pros and cons or the features of these two types of transplants? Mostly allogenic transplants, because they are associated with high morbidity and mortality, approximately 20 to 30%. Associated mortality with allogenic stem cell transplant. Therefore, it is carried out in patients who are young and fit relatively. So 40 to 50 years is average. It can range from 20 to 60 years. Autologous transplants, relatively in the elderly, 60 or 70 years. It can be otherwise also. The ranges will be earlier also, but mostly you can take it up to the age of 60 to 70. Our day-to-day practice, we take it maximum up to 65 years. Then the allogenic transplant, the main problem is to find a closely HLA matched sibling or an unrelated donor, whereas in autologous, you do not require that because it is taken from the same patient itself. Most serious complication, GVHD, as we said, that is the most important complication, but at the same time, since we have a GVL effect also, graft versus leukemia effect also, therefore the chances of having a relapse is much less. Whereas in autologous transplant, relapse of original disease is again possible, because when you are using it in a patient having already a cancer, there are sometimes chances that the harvest will have some sort of cancer cells. So the relapse of original disease is higher in autologous transplant. Anti-cancer effect of infused cells, proved or suspected in number of cancers, whereas it is not proved in the autologous ones. And the allogenic transplant used in non-malignant disorders, it is curative in both the genetic, immunological, as well as in the cancer patients. But in autologous transplant, not useful until gene therapy becomes. So these are the most common differences between the autologous and allogenic transplant. So when we are thinking of an allogeneic transplant, you have to identify a donor first. It may take a couple of months. Therefore, right at the outset, if you find a patient of acute myeloid leukemia or an acute lymphoid leukemia, then according to the risk stratification, if a patient needs a transplant, right from the outset, at diagnosis of the disease itself, you have to identify a donor. Pre-transplant testing is done, then BMT, and then immediate post-transplant and long-term follow-up. So this is what we talked about, how the stem cells are collected and how it is being given. And as I said, morbidity and mortality is higher with the allotransplant because of the GVHD. And how we condition a regimen. For autologous transplant, I said it is mostly the high-dose chemotherapy which we give. But for allogeneic transplants, even there is a role of radiation. So we start it actually from day -7, -6 onwards to have a higher amount of the stem cells in the peripheral blood and also the conditioning regimen. And day zero is considered the day in which the stem cells are infused into the patient. And from then onwards, we say it as day plus 1 to day plus 100 is very important. Within day plus 14, that means the nadir occurs by this time, the nadir of the neutrophil count, the fall in the neutrophil count. And since during this time, day 0 to day 14, a patient may have a total neutrophil count of 0 and the total leukocyte count of approximately 10 or 20 or 5 even. And in these cases, it is the time where there is highest chance of infection and highest chance of transplant related mortality, that is known as the TRM. And after that, from day 14 to day 28, there occurs engraftment. That means the neutrophils will start rising up because the stem cells have now entered into the niche and they have started dividing. After day 28 till day 100, this is the period when there is maximum acute GVHD. Post day 100, there occurs chronic GVHD, and this is mostly for the allogeneic stem cell transplant. Immunosuppression is required so that while we are conditioning for allogeneic transplant, we are preparing a field inside the recipient's bone marrow so that it will receive the stem cell of the donor, and there should be adequate immunosuppression also. The T cells are also all depleted so that it does not reject the graft. Graft rejection is also a very important cause of mortality. If the patient does not engraft by day 28, that means it might be a graft failure or there might be a graft rejection also. So this time is very, very crucial in patients undergoing stem cell transplant. And here actually comes the major role of critical care medicine, where we require their help to take the patients out of the infections. So this allogeneic stem cell transplant can be from a sibling donor, from a syngenic or an identical twin, from an unrelated donor or an haploidentical donor. So how do we select a donor? Understanding the HLA or the human leukocyte antigen. And it is by the typing we do for the HLA matching, that is known, the procedure is known as HLA matching. And who can be the donors? The siblings, also the unrelated donors. Siblings, there is 25% chance of being a full match, only 25% chance. And 50% chance of being half match. And the rest 25% chance, it will be less than a half match. So you can see that everybody may not have the same or a full 10 by 10 match. The importance of 10 by 10 match is that if a patient is fully matched, then GVHD and GVL will be minimal. And hence the morbidity and the mortality will be minimal. The more the mismatch, the more the amount of GVHD and the more the amount of toxicity. So this is what is depicted in the figure. See, they can be maximum 50% haploidentical, 25% identical, and 25% unidentical. So this is what I talked about. Full match means 12 by 12. There are actually six components where HLA B, C, HLA DR, HLA DQ, and HLA DP. So these are the six regions on the chromosome number 6. And if it is fully matched, it is known as 12 by 12 match. When we even go for a 6 by 6 match, if these are from the same, the sibling of the same parents. If we go for a MUD registry, then we look at 12 by 12 match because we also look at the high resolution matching of the HLA between the donor as well as the recipient. Suppose a donor, how do we select a donor when we have more than equal to two HLA match siblings? So this is again important. Why? Because we do not want TRM, the transplant-related mortality or the morbidity. So donor selection, whenever there are more than two HLA siblings fully matched are available, we have to look into age. The younger the age, the better it is as a donor. Sex and then the fertility. Suppose a patient is male, it is better, or an unmarried female, because once the patient is a female is having children, then she will have some sort of antibodies as after the parity, and the number, the more the number of parity, the greater the number of the antibodies inside the donor's body. CMV status, those who are negative is better. Then is the ABO, same blood group is the best, but if it is not there, then we have to see which will be the best. And then this is how we go about for a transplant. So stem cell transplant in India actually first started in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, and it was on the 8th of March. This is what was shared by Dr. Naveen Khetri, one of the pioneers of bone marrow transplant, and he's heading the team at TMH. It is his slide from there. And you can see the cost of BMT in India, almost from the matched sibling, it is 10 to 12 lakhs. Now it is up to 15 lakhs. And the more the disparity, it will again further go by 10 lakhs. In haploidentical donors, the cost is around 30 lakhs. So we have some data of the Indian Stem Cell Transplantation Registry. You can see that MUD is least, and it is mostly with the matched related donor, the fully matched related donor, or if it is unrelated in one or two points. So Indian Stem Cell Registry, mostly autologous and allogenic. For autologous, the myeloma is the most commonly used for the autologous stem cell transplant. And among the allogenic, AML, acute myeloid leukemia, and then next is the thalassemias. So these are the most two common diseases which, in which there are indications to go for stem cell transplant. We talked a little bit about haplo, that means half matched. And since this is now the buzz of the town, because we don't have much of matched sibling donor, only 25% chances. So haploidentical donors are now being more used, and based upon the conditioning regimen, you can have a good outcome. So most important is adequate dose, sufficient stem cell dose, and memory T cells for immune reconstitution. This is very important to understand when a patient undergoes a haploidentical transplant. So before transplant, we have to have some pre-transplant evaluation so that a patient is found fit to undergo a transplant. And this is the screening protocol which we even use in our center. So next, the topic which is most important to the audience over here is the critical care of the stem cell transplant patients. Approximately 15% of the patients require critical care. This is Western data. And what I would mention is ours is approximately 45% of the patients will require critical care because of the more chance of the MDRO or the multi-drug resistant organism infections. The immunologic milieu is markedly altered after HSCT. I showed you the period during which the maximum chances of infection are there. Respiratory failure and sepsis are the most common causes of critical illness after HSCT, and the complications can affect any organ. So it is very important to have ICU setups while you are a good ICU setup rather when you are undergoing a stem cell transplant or taking up this procedure in your unit. So most commonly encountered things we will be discussing about, the first is the engraftment syndrome. You can see over here the chest X-ray. It is more like a trolley or an ARDS, and happens is it occurs within 7 to 14 days after the stem cell transplant. That occurs, engraftment means when the neutrophil starts to recover. So that is the time of neutrophil recovery. First 7 days is the time of severe aplasia of the marrow, and subsequently from 7 to 14 days, it will start to slowly recover. That means then your neutrophils will start coming up like 5, 10, 15, then it will go up to 500. So this is the time when the engraftment occurs. What's the postulation? It is thought to be caused by the earlier recovery of neutrophils than the regulatory T cells, which leads to uncontrolled neutrophil activation. It is said that the Tregs are required to suppress the neutrophil action. And if the neutrophils come up earlier than the Tregs, then there will be this sort of an engraftment syndrome. And how do the patients present? There will be fever, there will be capillary leak, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, organ dysfunction. And this seems to be higher after the haploidentical HSCT than a fully matched. As I said, always prefer a fully matched sibling donor because the outcomes are better, the rejection is less, complications are less. The more the number of mismatches, the more is the amount of the toxicity. So management, how do we manage this? In severe cases, steroids, you have to keep patients in negative balance like the way they do in in ARDS, and otherwise steroids may be helpful. The other type is the cytokine release syndrome. These two are different entities. Compared with the bone marrow, the peripheral blood stem cells include more mature donor T cells in the transplanted product. Therefore, the higher T cell dose can result in profound cytokine release syndrome. And this is again having the features which is almost mimicking that of the engraftment syndrome, like the fever, vascular permeability, hemodynamic instability, AKI, and respiratory failure. This also occurs more commonly with the haplotransplants because they are the higher T cell dose and the more amount of the disparity between the matching, and typically results when post-transplant PTCYV, say post-transplant cyclophosphamide, is given as GVHD prophylaxis. Actually, PTCY is done to deplete these T cells. So the lesser the number of T cells by the treatment of the cyclophosphamide, the lesser is the cytokine release syndrome. Management here remains the same with steroids, but at expense of, why it is important, because cytokine release syndrome, that is the time when actually the engraftment also occurs. And if you are giving steroids at that point of time, there might be a chance that the graft might be rejected. So it is important that the cytokine release syndrome has to be managed with, if you can spare the steroids and you can use anti-IL-6 therapy with tocilizumab, that is a better option rather than to go with steroids. So this is what we talked about. There is a grading of the CRS, grade 1 to grade 4. Grade 4 is the worst part, where the patient requires mechanical ventilation with grade 4 organ toxicities, and grade 1 is managed just symptomatically. So you can see over here that mortality after HSCT is mostly because of the infections. In autologous transplant, it is 5% to 7%, whereas in allogenic transplant, it goes from 20% to 40%. The more the disparity, the more the chances of infection, because we are using regimens which are myeloablative so that the patients are able to, the recipient is able to take up the graft. So the incidence, this is the EBMT data. EBMT is European Bone Society of Bone Marrow Transplant, and the incidence of infection, you can see over here, we have fungal infections, bacterial infections, as well as viral infections, and these actually differ with the time of onset of these various infections is depends upon the time of recovery of the marrow, the time since the transplant has taken place. And similarly, in the autologous transplant, you can see the viral is least, whereas in the allo-SCT, towards the later part, after the day of engraftment, the viral is the most important pathogen, whereas in autologous, the viral is the least, most common is the bacterial. Fungal also is more common with the allogenic stem cell transplant. It is lesser with the autologous stem cell transplant. So here you can see, as I mentioned earlier, that phase 1, day 0 to day 30, but then phase 2, that is post-engraftment, it is day 30 to day plus 100, and the late phase is day 300, day 100 to more than 1 year. Risk factors in the pre-engraftment, that is up to mostly day 14 to day 28, there is severe neutropenia, the barrier breakdown with decreased amount of T cells and B cells. There is functional asplenia. Therefore, you will find mostly the bacterial infections, sometimes aspergillus infections, and then the candida infections are there. Viruses occur in the later part mostly, in the post-engraftment and in the late phase. And in the second phase, there is the acute GVHD is more common, day 30 to day 100. This is very, very important because acute GVHD also causes a lot of CMV reactivation. We will have some slides on that. And in the late phase, you know, the chronic GVHD, which again leads to a number of increase in the viral infections. So respiratory failure is to infection, and it is the most common reason of ICU admission after HSCT. At least 15% develop ARDS with a mortality of 50 to 70%. Empiric antimicrobial therapy should typically cover Pseudomonas, very, very important for us as transplanters, resistant gram-positive and atypical pneumonias. Patients undergoing the allo SCT, they should be put on antifungal prophylaxis. We have a whole session on antifungal in hematological malignancies, and allo SCT is one of the prime indication to have a patient on antifungal prophylaxis, and our drug of choice is posaconazole. Respiratory viruses are the next most important, and most of the patients will definitely have at some point of time exposed to any viral infection. These are the common pathogens. I won't go through that. Next is management of the respiratory failure. NIV is frequently used in HSCT based on older reports of mortality reduction with NIV compared with the invasive mechanical ventilation in the immunosuppressed patients. So this is preferable. However, heated, humidified, high flow nasal cannula oxygen, HFNO, which was very common during the COVID pandemic, is a new option in early respiratory failure. ECMO is used in severe ARDS, but it has had a very poor outcome because the patients terminate in an end stage and they are hardly salvageable at that point of time. Diagnostic yield and clinical utility are highest if bronchoscopy is performed within 24 hours of ICU admission. This is very, very important to differentiate between whether you are having a viral or a fungal infection or a bacterial infection. So BAL is safe even with profound thrombocytopenia. Many times intensivists ask us whether with a platelet count of 10,000, 20,000, will we be able to do a BAL, but it is quite safe and it is rather life-saving for a patient undergoing HSCT to be done at the earliest. And this is what you have to keep in mind as an intensivist, how to manage the patients with respiratory failure in HSCT patient. So diffuse alveolar hemorrhage is also very important to keep as a differential in mind because these patients are thrombocytopenic and it occurs in approximately 12% of HSCT patients, which is quite significant. And the drug of choice again over here is steroids. So we have to be very cautious regarding the use of steroids because it can be used in GVHD, it can be used in these conditions. And at the same time, since the patient is neutropenic, therefore the steroids may cause a havoc also in these patients. So you have to give your patients optimally antibiotic coverage, antiviral coverage, atypical coverage, as well as start steroids. So neutropenic sepsis is febrile neutropenia as such a completely a topic which will be completely discussed in detail. The most common pathogens you can see over here are the ones which are present as such in the urogenital as in the GI tract. Next is the viral infections. I'll speak a little about it because we haven't touched in any of the other topics in this webinar. So viral infections most common are the HSV, the varicella, the CMV, HHV6, EBV and the BK virus. Sporadic infections can occur with a number of the influenza and the adeno and rhinovirus. So important is CMV infections because it causes a lot of morbidity in patients of allogenic stem cell transplant. It is most common and significant complication after HSCT. Cumulative incidence is approximately 36%, but in our patients, I think approximately 80 to 90% of our patients have it, and as the figure over here shows. CMV end organ disease, that is pneumonia, can occur in 10 to 30% of the patients and it can be life-threatening. The CMV disease is costly and it causes a prolonged hospital stay and it is associated with a high mortality as well. So direct effects, breakthrough CMV disease can occur even after prophylaxis. Late CMV disease can occur even after day 100 of transplant. Resistant CMV disease, which are not usually getting cured with the anti-CMV viral agents. Indirect effects, when the patient has a CMV reactivation, they are also predisposed to bacterial infection, fungal infection, and having GVHD. And you know that CMV assays directly can cause myelosuppression, as well as the anti-CMV drugs, which can cause myelosuppression. So how do we manage them? First is you have to pick up that the patient is having CMV. So serology, CMV DNA, antigen PP65. Then you have to, the most important is how, if we can prevent it. But in India, the chances of prevention is less because most of the patients and the donors are exposed to CMV. So donor selection and the blood product transfusion is important. CMV negative means they should be lymphocyte depleted. Prevention of CMV disease, donor selection, prophylaxis, preemptive treatment. And then once CMV has set in, you have to treat the patient. There is no other way to prevent it. So the risk is R and D represents the recipient and the donor. If both are negative, risk of activation is 0%. Overall survival is very good. If recipient is negative and the donor is positive, then 30% chance of reactivation. If the recipient is positive in both the cases, and if the donor is negative or positive, then there is 80% chance of reactivation, and this is what happens in Indian cases because most of them are CMV positive, both the recipient as well as the donor. So you can see that serology before transplant determines the risk of disease after transplant if based upon the positivity or negativity. So impact on survival, those who are positive, the CMV donor who is positive and who is negative. If it is negative, it has a better survival. Those who are positive for CMV, they have a decreased survival. Similarly, over here, based upon the donor, the survival is low if the donor and the recipient both are positive. So what are the factors which causes the CMV reactivation? Use of a myeloablative regimen, and then the serology. If a patient is having graft versus host disease, then also they are at increased risk of having CMV reactivation. Graft source is important. If a patient is having marrow transplant, then the source of CMV is higher than that of a peripheral blood or an umbilical cord blood stem cell transplant. Then in the younger patients, you will find less of CMV infection than in the elderly, because the more we are exposed to the environment, the more amount of the CMV infection we will have. So these are some of the important small things, but they are important to keep it in mind, because CMV as such causes a high amount of morbidity in these patients. So this was graph which shows that the model assessing the CMV viral load as a time-dependent risk factor for CMV disease 1 year after HSCT, stratified by the use of preemptive therapy. Even after giving a preemptive therapy, there are chances, but the incidence relatively decreases and the risk of the cytomegalovirus infection decreases if we start the patient of preemptive therapy. So many of the centers have now started to use, like the way antifungal is given as a preemptive therapy, similarly, anti-CMV therapy is also being considered to decrease the viral load and the reactivation of the CMV disease. So we said this. So what is this? The prophylaxis, we can go with ganciclovir, acyclovir, valacyclovir, foscarnet, letermovir. This is one of the new drugs and it is not available till now in India, but in foreign countries like in US and the UK, this has really bring down significantly the CMV reactivation. Since they have lesser donor and recipients who are exposed to CMV, and with the availability of this drug, they say that the incidence of CMV has now decreased to approximately less than 10%. Then the preemptive treatment, ganciclovir, valganciclovir, foscarnet, and sidofovir. You know that these drugs are costly. At the same time, they are very toxic also and cause marrow suppression. And since this is a bone marrow or stem cell transplant where already the marrow is suppressed, to give these drugs is really challenging when it comes to the part of the physician. And once you establish that there is CMV viral load has increased or there is reactivation, you have to treat the patients with the following. And CMV CTL is cytotoxic T lymphocytes. These are T lymphocytes which are directed against CMV. This is a type of cellular therapy, and these are now upcoming ones which are actually not available in India, but many of the centers in the Western world are practicing it with a very encouraging result. Few words on acute GVHD, major contributor to the morbidity and mortality. Why it happens? Caused by the donor origin T cells, which recognize recipient tissues as foreign. And hence, they will elicit an immune response and try to avoid the graft from being taken upon by the recipient. It occurs generally within the first 100 days after transplant and can affect mostly the skin, mucosa, intestinal tract, and liver. These four organs are the most often targeted. And hence, symptoms are according to the organ which it affects. Steroids are the primary therapy, very, very important. Acute GVHD, which is not responsive to steroids, may put the patient in a disastrous end if the patient is not responding to steroids. Because GVHD prophylaxis has improved, therefore, overall GVHD mortality is decreasing. So based upon the signs, there are staging or grading of the acute GVHD. And as you know, zero means the best one, and stage four is the worst, resulting in life-threatening complications. So next is the vascular access. In HSCT patients, some our colleagues in the ICU help us with. And this is something which is generally done by the patients. But important to know is choose a compressible site, because these patients are thrombocytopenic. So we do not prefer the femoral line, which is not compressible or very well accessible. Subclavian sites have lower infection rates. Avoid femoral, use strict aseptic technique. Use POCUS for, that means the point of care, ultrasonography. For procedural guidance, because a number of punctures may result the patient in hematoma, consider micropuncture access techniques. Antibiotic impregnated catheters are better because they are very susceptible to infections. And adhesive securement devices may decrease bleeding and infection from the site rather than using sutures. So summarizing the whole topic, the HSCT recipient outcome does not just depend upon the physician who is transplanting, but it is a combined effort of a number of teams apart from the transplant physician, that is the critical care unit. Nursing is very, very important. Without a proper nursing staff, we cannot do transplant, because a nursing care is the most important part of it to avoid infections, which can result in the death of the patient, and that is the most important cause of mortality. Lab and radiology support throughout. GVHD can occur at any point of time, so a radiologist and a lab should be there at the bedside, or rather they should be at 24 hours service for that. Infectious disease physicians, that is important to pick up whether the patient is having a viral, a fungal, or a bacterial infection. So the whole team needs to be alert whenever a transplant process is going on. So without that, it can never be a success. HSCT volumes are increasing, no doubt. The association of earlier ICU admission with improved survival shows the need of adequate HSCT critical care facilities. So the earlier you pick up that the patient is worsening, or he is entering into a phase where he requires more of monitoring, that is when you shift the patient to the ICU. And this is my last slide. And what are the challenges which we are facing in our sector and in India? The numbers do not match the requirement. And the number of the thalassemias, the number of leukemias who require transplants are much higher than the number of the centers which are affording this facility. Infrastructure, we require more BMT wards, we require more HEPA filter wards. But having wards is not sufficient. We need trained medical and paramedical staff. This is utmost important. And the clinical, like our patients present, the duration of diagnosis to transplantation is quite long. As a result, they are heavily pre-transfused, resulting in alloimmunization and rejection of grafts. Usually not leukodepleted, irradiated blood. That is why most of our patients are CMV positive. Around 30% patients are severely infected because of the MDRO which are present, more than 90% being exposed to the ISS. So these are all which all have a negative impact to the outcome of the transplant. Next, most important is the financial cost. Government, some of the government schemes do not support the cost of transplant. public health care programs and the charity support. This is also required in a much greater way than what is present now. Insurance schemes, many of the insurance schemes, they also do not cover transplant. And the next is, because we do not have matched sibling donors much, we have to depend upon the MUD registry. That means matched unrelated donor registry. We have a Datri registry, which actually has a lot of number of donors. And we expect that the number of donors should still go higher up once people are aware how to donate stem cells in the registry. So this is what is the scenario of stem cell transplantation in India. And I would be happy to take up questions if there are any. Thank you so much.